dire d'ores et déjà qu'on va avoir très très chaud.
C'est simple, une canicule si précoce, si intense, c'est une première en France au mois de juin. Des températures records, 12 à 15 degrés au-dessus des normales de saison.
Et oppressive heat rising northwards across the whole of the UK. London, 39 degrees, breaking the July record.
Mittwoch erfasst die Hitze dann auch das ganze Land. Wir sehen 33 Grad in Berlin, 37 Grad in Frankfurt.
C'est toute l'Europe qui suffoque. Des records de température ont été battus aux Pays-Bas, en Belgique, en Italie. La Terre vit en ce moment sa période la plus chaude depuis 2000 ans. Alors, est-ce que ce fait de l'homme, ce réchauffement est-il irréversible?
Summer 2019 in Europe illustrated the urgency of the climate crisis, which claimed its first victim, water.
The demand is going straight up and the supply is going straight down. I mean, it is stark, it's stark.
A-t-on manqué d'eau cet été? Le niveau des nappes phréatiques inquiète. Les pluies de l'hiver n'ont pas été suffisantes pour reconstituer les réserves.
In France, nearly two-thirds of all regions are affected by water restrictions. Farmers have seen their crops destroyed while others try to adapt to climate change. After two record-breaking heat waves.
Today, 70% of the Earth's pure water is used for human consumption. It has become the most coveted resource on the planet.
Try not doing anything that requires water today and see how you go. You won't be wearing any clothes. You won't be using your mobile phone. You won't be driving in a car. You won't be living in a house. You won't be having breakfast. You won't be having lunch. You won't be having dinner. Water is in everything that we do.
To save humanity, Wall Street wants to start a revolution. Make water profitable and create water markets just like oil markets.
Water falls from the sky, therefore it should be free. Whenever I hear that, I always say, diamonds occur in nature and they're not free.
It's a financial product, like any other financial product.
The market is changing a bit over the last couple of weeks. It's around $485 to $495 a megalitre market today.
You're just at the beginning of this water financial revolution.
What about the guy that can't afford it? That guy still needs water.
The blue gold rush has begun. Can anyone stop it?
The human right to water means that it's not a charity, it's an issue of justice. This is the issue of our time. This is the crisis of our time.
With financial pressure on human mobilization rising, the battle over water has already begun. Who will come out on top? The planet? The people or the markets? London, the financial capital of Europe. Here is where the relationship between water and finance first began 30 years ago. At the time, it was simply a question of commending the virtues of privatization. It was Margaret Thatcher, Prime Minister at the time, who championed the cause.
That even socialist France knows privatized water is a better deal than nationalized water. That the water privatization, I believe, will go very successfully indeed.
What happened was the entire system, the entire physical system, as well as the concession, was sold to the private companies. every drop of water in the pipes is a private commodity. One of the first things some of the companies did was to start cutting off water supply to people who hadn't paid their bills.
The number of people who've had their water cut off for failing to pay their bills has almost trebled in a year.
One company, for example, disconnected 11,000 customers. And as far as the company was concerned, they could stay disconnected. If they didn't pay their bills, they didn't get any water.
I was out on Wednesday, I come back 9 o'clock and I got no water.
How far do you have to come?
Right the way across there, up on the top floor.
How many times do you think you'll have to make this journey then during the day?
Well, I've just come down again, well, probably another 4 or 5 times. I mean, you've got to have something to drink, haven't you? You've got to do some cooking. We didn't even have to queue for this during the wartime.
I said myself, it's disgusting.
But from the market perspective, that doesn't matter. The market couldn't care less if people die of cholera. Really, that's not their job. Their job is making money, and they've done that very well.
Finally, 10 years later, a law is passed that prohibits companies from cutting off the water supply to those who haven't paid their bills. But this is not enough to deter the financiers. On the contrary, in the early 2000s, a new generation of traders enter the world of water, namely private equity funds, or vulture funds. They are hungry and completely unaccountable.
They may be funds which have a 10-year life. And they need to get their returns over that decade that they will be the owners, and then they need to find a new owner. So you have a lot of international investors, people who may never have been to a water plant in Yorkshire at all, or may never have been to Yorkshire.
Finance is a wonderful business, and for all these techniques, you don't need to know anything about water, and you don't need to care anything about water.
The new owners arrive from Canada, Hong Kong, and Malaysia. In London, Thames Water, the distribution authority that covers 20% of the country, is bought by the Australian-based Macquarie Funds.
I was aware of Macquarie. I mean, they were quite a famous institution in Australia, where they'd been known as something, I think they were called the Millionaire's Factory, because so many people who worked at Macquarie became very rich as a result of the bonuses that they earned.
Macquarie were one of the first private equity companies to say these are good places to be. One of the simple reasons for that is, if you observe, there is and is going to be population growth. If there's population growth, there's going to be more water being drunk.
David Hall is the man who revealed this water scandal. In 2017, he published a study in which he detailed 30 years of abusive practices. Rising bills, soaring dividends to shareholders, and tax evasion. A caricature of financial capitalism.
We ended up concluding that about £2.5 billion per year was being taken out of the system by private capital. Now, the main reason for that was that the dividends they were paying themselves were very high and very regular.
So these companies were perfect cash machines.
They still are. They still are. Everybody believes, correctly, that we are being swindled by the water companies.
What David Hall's study then did was it said, is this really how you think that essential services should be exploited, I think is the best way, by financial interests so aggressively?
The Australian-based Macquarie Funds supplied London with drinking water for 10 years. Their parting gift when they left the market? $56 billion of debt.
Somebody at that point will have to repay all those borrowing. Well, there's only one source of money in the whole water industry, and that is the customer. And when the customer has to repay those borrowings, that will affect the charges they have to pay. And of course, the owners will never return the dividends they've taken out. Those have just gone. I think they take a view that this is a victimless crime. The funny thing about the UK's experience with water privatisation is no one else in the developed world has done it. It's a one-off. And sometimes you have to ask yourself, why is it?
Today, over 80% of Britons would like to go back to a time when water was a common, public, and essentially free resource. But this concept is slipping away.
Through another 24 hours of extreme heat. Overnight, it barely dipped below 30 degrees in many parts of the state, with temperatures soaring into the mid to high 40s during the day.
Fire conditions, particularly through South Australia, where the mid-north has been rated as catastrophic and the Mount Lofty Ranges has been rated as extreme. It remains extremely hot through the southeast today, with temperatures 10 to 16 degrees above average. Strengthening northerly winds.
Australia, the hottest continent on the planet, on the front line of climate change. Here, drought is a part of everyday life. In this parched country, Australians are getting closer and closer to tomorrow's world. A world where water is a scarce and expensive resource. Bart Dohan is a dairy farmer who lives in New South Wales, one of the driest regions in the country. For many months now, his reserves have been empty. The only solution for feeding his animals is to buy extra water on the private market.
Come on, girl. You're not. That's the girl.
Today, to run just for my cow, it cost me close to $500,000 for 12 months of water. $500,000.
Can you afford that?
It would put a great deal of strain on us if we did it. A great deal of strain.
Hey.
Like, we know a farm in the last 3 months has already spent $1 million on water. A storm could come through tomorrow and wipe it all out too. So it's, they've spent the money, but it's still a gamble from whether it's going to work or not. We're trying our best to keep the cows alive. Of course, we can't afford the water to grow crops for the cows. We can't afford a real lot of grain. They're getting very little or no grain at all at the moment. So they're producing 50% less than what they should be for this time of year. It's just a survival mode, trying to survive, keep our cows going, and try and get out the other end of it. Australia used to be a place of mates and helping each other out, but now it's sort of like dog-eat-dog world at the moment, especially with the water policy.
Water has become like gold. It is bought and sold with a single click, thanks to mobile phones and an application connected to the market, available 24 hours a day. Its price changes daily, depending on supply and demand.
It's there, I can touch it, I can paddle my feet in it, but I can't use it. Not unless I've got that money.
Once the transaction is approved, irrigation channel valves open automatically and pour out millions of litres to customers, those who can pay.
People are just taking water from us, and it's taking our life. It's taking our food from our table, more or less. Why we'll be doing it is hopefully next year the rivers are full and that we don't have to go back onto that open market to buy water again. Will it happen? Will it not? We don't know. We might as well play Russian roulette.
To combat water shortages, the Australian government has chosen to ration it. Each year, it allocates a quota to the major water consumers, farmers, industrialists, and cities. This is calculated based on activity, existing reserves, and weather forecasts. Along with this new law, called the Water Act, water markets have been created where anyone can come and purchase additional rights or sell some of their own.
I just want to give you a call as the market is changing a bit over the last couple of weeks since we last spoke and changed water down to 520. And we're seeing trading really happening around that $485 to $495 a megalitre mark.
Harding from Waterfind. Thanks, Pete. Look forward to hearing from you.
In just 10 years, the water business has become the new El Dorado with a turnover of $2 billion per year.
Morning. Yeah, I am. 9 o'clock, first thing. Yeah.
Waterfind is the world's leading water stock exchange. They work with the megalitre, a unit of measurement equivalent to 1 million litres.
Some of my team here call me the water market pioneer. So I'd like to say that I'm a pioneer in the world.
How much more has he got in that order to go then?
Well, since I had to do a manual transfer, he's only got, I think he had a balance of 6 weeks.
It was we'll reset that again then. And
he had a remaining balance of 304 megalitres.
Yeah.
That we secured that.
Yeah.
So yeah, I did a manual transfer for 250 megs. Plus the
so prices today are around the $500 per megalitre or per million litres. You've got... I think it's cheap. what, $500? What's that, 300 euros or 350 euros for 1 million litres of water? I'd say that's pretty cheap when you look at it from that perspective. Isn't it a good thing that we are finally putting a value on this resource? Because in putting a value on it, we're going to respect it more.
In this new world, every drop counts. Water is no longer a natural resource, but a commodity. In the world of water markets, the key players are the agricultural industry, as is the case with Webster, the country's largest producer of almonds. The directors of this company are among the richest water owners, at the head of a reserve worth more than $200 million. Their almonds are mass cultivated and exported all over the world. In relation to the amount of water used, this is their most profitable crop. On this farm, Brendan Barry has the title of water manager. This is a new area of expertise.
That there, that's a wood colony. Not, they're not quite ready. But if you grab that.
They're big.
Yeah, they're bigger, but the taste of them is just a different flavour.
But the nonpareil are the real.
Nonpareils, there's other nuts bigger than that, but these are the best seller, that's why. And they crop pretty well, so that's why everyone sort of keep them as 50% of the orchard.
Yeah.
The easiest to market and whatnot.
The total value of our water is more valuable than all the land we hold or the plant and equipment or the livestock that we hold. The water market in this area this year has gone from about $320 per megalitre to over $700 per megalitre, and that's in a period of around 5 months.
Double
the price, but that's how it works.
As water manager, Brendan is more of a trader than a farmer.
A big stack of grain has a value, that's money. Water is no different in that sense. In our business, we want to use our water efficiently because if we do that, we can drive a greater profit into the business.
And that's what we're ultimately here for, is to deliver a profit for the shareholders. These are the things that are interesting or useful.
He manages his stock with the help of a specialised broker, Lex Batters. He too embodies the new generation of businessmen looking to exploit water. For them, drought means good business.
It's worthwhile mentioning it to you, I guess.
No, that's all right.
Yeah.
You got any interest in leasing it out? I don't think there's, you know, thousands of megalitres on the market at the moment up here. The market doesn't seem to be terribly logical at the moment. In our view, it's a sort of greed and fear market, and it's bit of a balance between the the two.
But that's because of where we are, and there's not that much water around, so people are fairly skittish. Frustrating, maybe. Anyway, that's the way it goes.
Yeah, and look, I think dairy is in such a state down there. You know, the number of herds getting sold at the moment is quite ridiculous.
Yeah.
That, from what I'm hearing, basically every dairy farm's on the market. So if you did want to do something down there, I think there's, you know, acquiring land's not going to be difficult.
Yeah. Who knows? Yeah. See where it goes to. Who knows? Anyway.
$20 got, you're up, you know, up. $120 got, and 80, and 300, 20, 40, 60, 80, and 400, 20, 40. Please, you're out,
you buying?
15,500 in the red corner. 15,500, anyone else? Yeah. And 5, 105 behind, 105.
It's fine. What did that sell already?
Yeah.
What did they get for that?
1,000, 800 for that one, I don't know what the little one made.
So you just stopped milking and you sold the farm too, have you?
Yeah.
Those yard blasts, have they had much use?
Never been used.
The water crisis and soaring prices have forced David Owen into bankruptcy. He has had to sell the family dairy farm and now joins the long list of victims of the water markets.
$700, anyone else? $700, $700.
It's an end of an era. I've been in this district all my life, so I haven't lived more than 10 kilometres from where I sit. So, yeah, it's a special day. Yeah. You look at your cash flows for the last 12 months and 4 years ago, and you realise you're spending more and more on water. And then Jenny said to me, you can't keep going on like this. So that conversation wasn't very nice. So I threw my dishes in the sink and stomped out. Yeah, so that was very emotional. Yeah. It's a bit like, it's probably not as much emotion as later on when we were selling cows. I can tell you who her mother is and who her grandmother and great-grandmother. In fact, so they tell me you'll get over it. I hope so.
Initially, the creation of water markets was welcomed by farmers. Big agricultural players saw it as an effective way to buy water, whilst others planned to supplement their income by selling their surplus. But 10 years later, the market had become ruthless.
There's lots of people that don't understand the water market. I don't understand the water market. Just unless you keep on to it all the time, you just don't know what's happening. And I don't think a lot of us know what's happening in the water market. Unless you're buying, you don't want to look at the water market, because lots of times it only depresses you. Especially if you're looking for water and you think, oh, it'll go down. No, it doesn't. It keeps going up.
Australia is on extreme alert as searing temperatures put emergency crews on notice and authorities ready to answer any major crisis. Records fell today and more are set to tumble tomorrow, with Adelaide forecast to hit 45 degrees, nudging the hottest day on record for the city. The CFS warns it won't be able to control any major...
Adelaide in southeast Australia, the driest city on the driest continent on the planet. Adelaide serves as a think tank. It's here at the university that the idea of water trading was conceived.
And in some years, you might get zero water. So they said nobody could take any more water, so you're going to have to find a way to share water. What happened very quickly, as a result of work that I did or started doing, I said, well, what we need to do is to unbundle the system and take a license, and you set up a bank-like accounting system and let everybody trade at low cost. And to do that, then all the regulations land. I said, well, why don't...
Mike Young is the founding father of the Australian water markets. A renowned economist, he attended Harvard University and has advised the United Nations. This is the man writing the new history of water.
Water scarcity is really there. So water scarcity is part of the future of the world. The global predictions are that by 2050, more than half the world will be living with limited water resources, and abundance is a thing of the past. Water needs to be managed in a very precious way. In a way that drives innovation, that makes sure our water goes to the best use as it possibly can, so we make money and feed ourselves well. And that led to the interest in water markets and drove a revolution.
The revolution started by Mike Young has turned climate change into a market force.
It's fascinating to see how sophisticated our water markets have become. If there's rain forecast in a week's time, the price of water will go down because farmers know they won't have to irrigate. If it's going to be really hot for the next fortnight, then the price of water goes up.
And I think the reason why you really come to a university is to make the world a better place to live in. So I teach a course on how to make the world a better place to live in. Come and enjoy it. Thank you.
Mike Young has opened up water markets to all. Farmers, small savers, and above all, professional investors. Nowadays, everybody can buy water on the stock market for consumption or simply for speculation.
When water becomes scarce, and as it becomes scarcer, then somebody has to stop using it. And what markets do is they discover and reveal the most appropriate people to pull out of agriculture. As it is for making cars, as it is for lots of things, we live in a competitive world.
Markets mature. Spot markets start, derivative markets for water, options, forwards, new intelligence and information systems. We're building artificial intelligence and machine learning.
Well, I suppose we're all in the game to make money, but make a living out of just trading water. So whereas we're just interested in getting water to make, buying water to make a living, not just making a living by buying and selling water. Yeah.
The system was put in for the farmers to create wealth for the economy. But it's been taken from the farmers now. So who's making the money?
Water purchased at the market price has drained the Australian countryside. Only the agricultural giants have the means to compete with the investors, who are pouncing on this new raw material.
At the moment, there's schemes going around the world to encourage investors to buy into the Australian water market with these returns that they're seeing. They own huge amounts of water and they're making huge money out of it.
Is water becoming the new Australian gold?
It is. If you can make a 25% return on your investment or better, or wouldn't you try and do it?
It was Melbourne's hottest day in 5 years. Temperatures hit 42.3 degrees.
In Melbourne City, a high of 42.8 at 1:38 this afternoon. Our hottest day in 5 years, a change hit around 2.
It was still more than 30 degrees at midnight in Melbourne and didn't get much.
The new Lords of Water live in the city of Melbourne, the business capital. They are bankers, insurers, pension and investment fund managers. And they are gradually taking control of this blue gold.
I don't need to own land. You know, would I own land? Would I consider it? Yes, but I'm not a farmer. I'm an investment banker.
How much did you invest?
Not much, maybe $20 million. The price of water has doubled, but in the next 10 years it will double again because of intensive agriculture. There's a lot of discontent between the farmers and the people who are controlling the water. And so the farmers sometimes look at these people as water barons or water bandits because they're controlling water that many times they can't afford.
Nicknamed the Water Bandit, David Williams rules over his empire from high up on the 45th floor. As an owner of expansive water reserves, he rents his water to farmers as others would rent land. And the future is looking bright.
If we go to 9 billion population and the Chinese want more food and the Indonesians want more food and the Indians want more food and they can afford to pay for it, then we need to find more intensive ways of growing food. That means more water. And that's going to lead you smack bang into how you get that water, how you price it, how you allocate it, and how you regulate it.
With the big investors buying water, it's getting back to the old days of the landlords and the peasant farmers. And if we want to survive or stay into it, we're going to have to buy the water at what the landlords deem the water is worth. Back to the Middle Ages, yeah.
In the name of fighting global warming, the Lords of Water have made an agreement with the environmentalists. A portion of lake and river water is now protected. It feeds the ecosystem and is kept out of the market. This alliance, brought about the large majority vote in favour of water reform.
As I'm talking to you today, we're about to have 7 days in a row here in Adelaide above 37 degrees Celsius. And that is the fourth time in 2 months where we've had that high temperature. Climate change is happening, and it's happening now, and it is impacting on the levels of water usage and the water that's being returned to the system. The river's struggling, and so we had to start putting a value on it.
Environmental organisations are now taking advantage of the markets to buy water and return it to nature.
The agriculture industry in Australia is worth billions of dollars. The value of water in Australia is worth even billions more. So if we want to make sure there's the river is kept alive, if we want to make sure there's water there for the future, we have to engage in that process. That, of course, forced a proper market for water buying and trading. Has Australia got it right yet? No, we don't. We might be the test case. We haven't got it 100% right.
Water was the last remaining natural resource to have escaped trading. But Australia has just blown the final whistle. The time has come for maximum profitability and the creation of wealth.
I'm Ngarinyiri elder. I speak on behalf of my people, on behalf of this land and this water. Water, for me and my people, is a part of who we are. It's a part of our stories, our creation stories. Today is different.
Australia has implemented water markets.
Yeah.
How do you look at that?
We don't like it very much. We don't like it at all.
Well, we'll see. We have to paint up everyone else first. Okay?
That's the tan line from my paint today.
Where's that?
Selling, trading, what does it? Filling your dams up, making sure that you've got your share, making sure that no one else takes yours. Part of it is madness, and most of it is greed. Greedy people. They want the water, but they also want that. And they'll sell it to somebody else for money. You can't eat money. You can't drink money. Water is like the veins in our body. Earth. Mother Earth is like our body. The water goes through it. Yeah. The river's got a spirit. The water is a water spirit. It feeds your spirit. Without that spirit, you die. We all know that. kangaroo. Pinyaling, open, 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 pinyaling, open, open. Pinyaling, yin, yin, yin.
If you thought the hot weather was bad this weekend, just wait until tomorrow. The fifth day of our heat wave is expected to be incredibly uncomfortable and potentially dangerous.
Very, very hot today. It's moving in from the Midwest, where they've been dealing with this sweltering heat. And now that it's moving here to the East Coast, it could stick around for several days, becoming a full-blown...
Make water a commodity. Listed on the stock exchange. Bet on its price. And if Wall Street replicates the Australian model... Ever since the subprime crisis, causing economic ruin for countries and individuals, the financial giants have been looking for new areas to invest in. In June 2008, the investment bank Goldman Sachs starts to wonder, is water the new oil? The firm invites its top clients to take a bet on the future.
Goldman Sachs, the conference, that was me. I used to work at Goldman Sachs, and in 2008, that was a conference that I held. There's this absolute intuitive appeal that says population growth is outstripping the water supply. That must mean companies that are engaging in the water business are a sure thing, that they can't miss. They get mesmerized by these megatrend appeals in water. Is water the next oil? We set it up as a question and then mostly dismissed it. Water does not have a sophisticated trading market and has no substitutes. That question's not going to go away. We're just probably not ready for it yet.
Goldman Sachs and its investors must wait. Public opinion is not ready yet. It's not until 2015 and the International Climate Change Conference in Paris that the world leaders finally declare a state of emergency.
If we act here, if we act now, if we place our own short-term interests behind the air that our young people will breathe and the food that they will eat and the water that they will drink and the hopes and dreams that sustain their lives, then we won't be too late for them.
In the developed world for the last 100 years, we haven't had to think about our water or worry about our water. It's been essentially unlimited wherever we want it, whenever we want it. It's been really inexpensive. No one thinks about their water bill. They don't say, oh, take a shorter shower, the water's too expensive. I think that era is over. Climate change is going to have a huge impact on water availability around the world. The same amount of water is going to be available in the big picture, but we don't live in the big picture. We live in a specific place. We raise our food in a specific place, and so the movement of that water will have a dramatic impact on how cities manage their water and how we're able to grow food to feed everybody.
The climate emergency demands radical changes. Wall Street re-embarks on its mission. Citigroup, one of the largest US banks, publishes a report announcing the end of free water.
They'd be wasting water on a gigantic scale in certain regions like California, southern Spain, we are seeing scarcity of water of sometimes extreme degrees. I mean, we have had tankers filled with water sailing to Barcelona. There is no alternative to pricing water properly and making people realize that every time they take a sip of water, there is an opportunity cost and they feel it in their wallet. How else are you going to get people to use less if you give it to them for free?
The dam has broken. The soft sounds of liberalism grow louder to celebrate the union of finance and water.
We are going to see asset markets selling water derivatives. Even the high-frequency traders, the hedge funds, would become interested. So no, everybody sees this as an opportunity that will come. The question is just when and who will push it first and hardest.
And what would be their motivation in coming?
Profits. While also, indirectly doing good for humanity. So it's the best of all possible worlds. What could be better?
It's very immoral to trade water.
Why would it be immoral to trade water?
Because water is life.
We pay for healthcare. Just because it's life doesn't mean it cannot be priced.
The last stage in the financialization of water. The launch of a stock market index to bet on water prices by NASDAQ, a stock exchange specializing in technology. This is the first time that water has been reduced to an algorithm. The man who came up with the equation works in central London. As a former trader in a Swiss bank, he launched the carbon markets, where industrialists trade rights to pollute in the form of credits, before he discovered water.
Water used to be free in the old world, but the world is changing. There's too much stress on the system, and the most important commodity on earth can't be free forever. If you wanted to put it into the greed scenario, if you don't control it and use it properly, what will theoretically happen is those with the cash will have it, and those without the cash won't have it.
Lance Coogan is the sort of man who looks to the future. In order to attract investors, he's joined forces with the top water expert in the United States.
And I'm going to drive around, and your dad's going to...
You just pull around to the side, Mom,
okay.
And we'll throw some hay on.
Scoot way back up there.
Look like the grain.
A cowboy living in Idaho, in the western United States. The only man who knows the secrets of a market that was, until now, reserved for experts and insiders. Clay Landry runs a company that has recorded every water transaction since the year 2000.
When I got the call, it was unusual. It was a little outside of our, our normal focus. I was intellectually curious, From our standpoint, it was relatively easy because we had the data.
These are all bulls.
Okay, we gotta go give them their dinner now.
Why?
Because they like lots of food, just like you.
It isn't a reliable index. To be clear, you're not buying water, You're buying the price of water.
Stuff.
So you're not taking physical delivery of the water.
So it's only a bet on the future?
It is a bet. Yeah, it is a bet. We're just betting whether the price is going to be high or low 6 months from now.
Some might say that this is speculation on what the price.
Is it a speculation? I think we all are managing on what we think the future is going to look like.
I didn't get to pet any of them.
You didn't get to pet any of them?
Water's free, nobody worry, we're all happy. That's going back into the dark ages. I was in the carbon market 2006 to 2012. People are talking to me like, what's this nonsense that you do? Now it's in the front page of the news. If what people are saying is coming, you better be on top of your water situation or you're going to be without water. And what I'm doing is getting people's focus through financial instruments to see what is actually going on the ground. It changes the world of water.
As in Australia, both partners have gained the support of powerful local environmental organizations. 10 years after the financial crisis, the financiers seem to be winning the environmentalists over.
Seeing more nonprofit organizations forming to participate in that market and begin looking at ways to acquire water in areas where it's needed for stream flow, either for fishery benefit, water quality benefit, or some other type of habitat protection. The environmental water trades make up about a quarter of the market.
Is it too late to stop a financial takeover bid on water?
As a week-long heat wave is letting up in the Midwest and Northeast, temperatures are rising to dangerous levels in the West. Excessive heat watches and warnings are posted tonight in parts of California. At the same time, nearly 40 large wildfires are burning across the West. They have burned.
California has built up its wealth through water. Here, the reserves are in the North, whilst the cities and farms are in the south. In order to domesticate this resource, a huge canal had been built, transporting billions of gallons of water, climbing over the mountains, irrigating the fertile valleys before supplying the people of Los Angeles. The California Aqueduct is the essential artery that ensures the life and prosperity of 40 million people. But climate change threatens the Californian dream.
California doesn't charge farmers for water. If they drill a well and pump out of the ground, they can pump as much as they want, whenever they want. Not only is there no charge, no one even keeps track of how much water they use. And during the last drought, which was just a year and a half ago, some of the farmers in the Central Valley of California were pumping so hard that the ground was falling. The ground was collapsing by an inch a month.
Lots of water, not so much water. We're right down there. So today I'm declaring a drought emergency in the state of California.
Record droughts and disastrous wildfires, too. California has been catapulted into the world of extreme weather phenomena.
Heavenly Father,
please help us. Please help us to be safe.
In the middle of the last drought, California passed a really important law that's going to change water use in the state forever. It may change what gets grown in California. It may change who succeeds and who fails.
Under pressure from environmentalists, the governor is forced to vote in a new law called SGMA, which limits underground water extraction. From now on, Californian farmers and cities will be entitled to a specific water quota based on their consumption. A revolution in the land of the free.
SGMA, or the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act, initially I think was viewed with fear and trepidation. I think people recognized that it was a necessary piece of legislation. Just like balancing your checkbook for your home, you can't live by writing checks for more money than you have. And so I think collectively the Valley has endorsed it and supports the idea of sustainability.
In Bakersfield, the local water agency has decided to create a stock exchange to allow farmers to buy and sell their quotas. 10 years after Australia, California is coming around to the concept of water markets.
And maybe you're July, and you say, wow, based on this projection, I'm going to have a supply surplus. You may decide, you know, I'm going to manage that. I'm going to go into the market and make that available and maybe generate some additional economic value.
So if it falls through afterwards, we hit confirm, and it falls through, they didn't pay or they didn't, you know, it doesn't work out, how do we let you know again that I want to take my water back? You know what I mean?
You can't. Once you hit confirm, as far as the district is concerned, the transaction is complete. Okay. There's going to be some growing pains, and certainly it's not going to be perfect every time, but we're trying to structure something that seems straightforward. Some of the people, the wheels were beginning to turn, and they were thinking, you know, can I turn this to my advantage? Is there a way for me to generate additional value? And I think just the word market invokes in people a sense of, is there an opportunity? Can I somehow be advantaged by participating? And that's by far the most common reaction that I have. When people hear that, you know, we're creating a market for water, I think they view it as an opportunity.
Contract with EDF. Right.
And they're not a platform provider. Right. They don't have skin in the game in terms of your bottom line.
Right. Here again, environmentalists are at the forefront, encouraging the establishment of these markets.
You know, we're here because we see it as an important tool for flexibility as folks are dealing with more and more scarcity under SGMA and, you know, climate change in general. So we've been talking to Eric for some time. Since this is ground zero for groundwater overdraft, it would be great to actually experiment with how water trading could benefit this region.
You know, the Valley here is definitely ground zero.
Yeah.
But there's groups in Sonoma, there's groups in Eastern Tule, Madera, Fox Canyon. Everyone probably knows about Fox Canyon.
Oh, sorry, my name is Christine Babbitt, and I work with...
Oh, you're Christine Babbitt.
Yeah.
Okay. I thought you were.
I'm Ann Hayden.
I'm very surprised that the pro-environment are pro-market.
I was too initially. I think, you know, after we had a chance to talk and understand what their interests were and recognize that we were very much aligned, these transactions have to be evaluated, not just from a financial standpoint, but we also have to take into account environmental impacts, water quality issues, all of the things that they're concerned about. And so it's good to have their input and their vision.
And so that answers your first question. I mean, we don't know. Right now, we're just kind of trying to project into the future.
Would you have imagined that situation before?
No. This is, I think, taken many of us by surprise. 4 or 5 years ago, this would not have been possible.
Why?
Supply has been constrained by definition of sustainability, and so the market, I think, is necessary.
Will California become the new Australia? Will intensive agriculture monopolize this resource? And will small farmers disappear, sacrificed in the name of water profitability? Wall Street's new creed.
People have been fighting over water since white people set foot in this valley.
It's our life. If we don't have water, we don't have an economy, and we don't have anything. You have the growers, you have the packers, you have the shippers, you have the manufacturers, but it's all based on what comes up out of the ground, and you need water for that.
Historically, the Central Valley has been the orchard that supplies the whole country with fruits and vegetables. Considered of national security, it ensures food independence for the United States. But over the past decade, the crops have changed. Salad leaves have disappeared, and the valley has become an almond-producing machine. As in Australia, the financialization of water is transforming landscapes and encouraging monoculture.
I can remember, because I grew up in the valley, you know, driving up and down and all over the place, that you had much smaller plots of land and farms and a lot more alfalfa and cotton, especially cotton. And now you have, you know, just as far as the eye can see in some areas, almond trees. As the price of water increases and it becomes more valuable than the land and more valuable than the production of the land, well, you have a commodity, it's valuable somewhere. If you can't use it on the land, what else might you be able to do with it? Farm it to sell.
So in a way, water is a new crop.
Yes, water is probably the most valuable crop in the Central Valley right now. It's more valuable than oil.
So what if blue gold were to replace black gold? John Vidovich is what's known as a water baron, a reference to the billionaires of yesterday who controlled the oil markets. He arrived one day in the valley, like a wolf entering a sheepfold.
I knew where LA was. I knew where San Francisco was. This Central Valley is something that was foreign to me. And after I bought the land, it was about 4,000 acres, I bought it for $270,000, and it had today's value, it had about $12 million worth of water rights in today's value, maybe more. And
a lot of people feel that John Vidovich, he's not a farmer, that he is a water farmer, that he buys these lands and gets himself involved in this stuff in order to get control of the groundwater.
My strategy has always been that it's not so much the land, but it's the water. And maybe I was a little bit early, maybe I wasn't.
How much have you invested in all these infrastructures?
I will say in the hundreds of millions. So that's what I have invested.
Hundreds of millions of dollars?
Yes, sir.
Does it worth it?
Yes, absolutely.
John Vidovich is not afraid of soaring water prices, nor the arrival of Wall Street investors. For him, the danger lies elsewhere.
Cities will always get water. The politics are there, the money is there. They can increase the cost of water so that the farmers can't pay for it. They're going to steal it by making it so expensive that the farmer is at their mercy.
The fear is it's all going to go to L.A. because L.A. has all the money. You know, that's the fear. Remember, MWD, the Metropolitan Water District, which is the big gorilla down south, they have millions of customers where you could spread the cost out and it's not going to affect the individual customer. Water is money. It's power and it's money, and it's becoming more and more and more valuable almost daily.
In the land of free enterprise, water competition is fierce. City against countryside, ecologists against farmers. Some people are already preparing to become water bankers, welcoming those who wish to stock their reserves before using or reselling them according to market prices.
Semi-tropics is really set up as a sponge to be able to capture as much water available when it's here. And then we have the luxury when the surface water is not available, we can fall back upon the stored water in the groundwater basin. Semi-tropic owns these canals. We paid for the canals, we maintain the canals, we built the canals. So if a landowner wants to actually have access to my canal to move a water supply they acquired, they're going to pay for it.
As a seller, it's more interesting to sell water to cities than to farmers.
Yeah, you probably have a higher ability to sell water to cities. But then again, where are those cities getting their food supply? Are they importing the food supply from outside the state, outside the country, or do they want to have a local food supply? Do they like having the natural stream system near their home? Where's the value? Is it fish? Is it farms? Is it people? That really, at the end of the day, is the hard issue for us to decide about where is the best use for water supply, and it varies based upon where you are.
The 20th century economy centered around the oil trade. Nowadays, water looks set to shape the 21st century.
We have seen financial investors and others come in and look at ways to, you know, take advantage of that. Their goal is to get in before the market elevates the price of water. And in some cases, I've heard that they've done it.
And how do you look at that?
There's some that feel that's kind of exploiting the system, but, you know, there's nothing that we can do to prevent it. May not like it, but that's the way our system, that's what capitalism is set up to accommodate.
Have you met them personally?
No.
Does it make sense? Should we be trading water? I think we're past that question. We are trading water in this country, and more people are moving to the West. They need water.
We're just at the beginning of this water revolution, the water financial revolution.
You can't let the market be the only decider of how water's allocated. Price can't be the only way you distribute water, because then you'll have rich people with big swimming pools and poor people who are dead.
Och SMHI går nu ut och höjer varningen för varma temperaturer från klass 1 till klass 2. Och det här är alltså den näst högsta varningsklassen. Det innebär att det råder extrem värme. Varningen den gäller för de flesta kommuner i Stockholms län.
The global water rush is accelerating. Privatization, competition, profit. Key words of the liberal doctrine. Faced with this threat, one woman is standing up, Maud Barlow, a Canadian human rights activist. She has already won her first victory at the United Nations in 2010, when the General Assembly voted in favor of a resolution that recognized access to water as a universal right.
It must be declared a public resource that belongs equally to
all. I was in the United Nations, up in the balcony, the day that they voted, and I thought we were going to lose. I had staff with me. They were crying. I said, don't worry. We're going to be back in 2 years or 5 years, no matter how long it takes. We're going to be back, and we'll do it. And when they vote, they sit in their chairs, and they vote electronically, so you know right away. So boom, 122 countries voted in favor, and 41, they abstained. They didn't have the nerve to oppose, even though they actually wanted to oppose.
Among the nations that abstained that day were Australia, the United States, and Great Britain, countries that have all chosen to turn water into a financial product.
The human family took an evolutionary step forward at that point, and since then, every country has ratified. It's in one way or another, it's now universal.
So you got it now.
You got it now.
Maud Barlow may have won the battle, but she hasn't yet won the war. In Stockholm in December 2018, the activist was invited by the Nobel Committee to continue her fight at a conference about the future of water.
So we thought we'd focus on activism for a while. And to start us off, I'd like to ask Maud Barlow to give us a talk, please.
The United Nations calls water scarcity the scourge of the earth. To truly guarantee the human right to water, we must protect it as a public trust and a commons, not a commodity to be put on the open market for sale like oil and gas. And we must challenge the current power structures and institutions that support unequal access to the planet's dwindling water supplies. Our goal must be clean, affordable, accessible, public water for all, for everywhere, for all time.
Is it the end of cheap and free water?
Well, the corporations and Citigroup and others want it to be the end of free and cheap water. That's their argument. They're saying, oh yes, it's a human right, because they can't fight that anymore because everybody says you're an awful person if you deny it, right? So, oh yes, it's a human right, but the end of free and cheap water. When they say it's got to be a commodity, it's because they know that the scarcer it becomes in a world where you desperately need water, there's gold. It's gold. It's blue gold.
In Stockholm, Maud Barlow appears as the grain of sand capable of bringing the water market machinery to a halt.
There are an awful lot of people in elite circles, and let's face it, the Nobel's pretty elite, that believe that the best thing to do for the water crisis is commodify it, put it on the open market like oil and gas, and see where it goes from there, right? So I for me, it represented a breakthrough in getting our message out that we have to see water as a human right, as a public trust, and something that belongs to everyone. That's our goal. It's a big goal, and not one everyone shares, I have to tell you.
Thank you so much for coming. Really, really, it was wonderful. Be activist now. Just go out and sometimes it'll be hard because sometimes you'll find nobody else. It's like, why me? Why don't other people care? And it's just the way it is. And you guys will do it. I know you will. You'll be our leaders.
The winds of revolt are strengthening. In Europe, the fight against the financialization of water is fueled by the refusal to accept any sort of privatization. And in the streets of Dublin, Rome, Berlin, and Paris, citizens are spearheading the resistance.
une vague de chaleur sur toute la France aujourd'hui, jusqu'à 42 à Paris, record battu.
Il fait vraiment très chaud, et ce, la nuit, difficile de faire baisser la température.
In the French capital, politicians have also taken up the fight. In 2009, the city council ousted Veolia and Suez, the two giants who shared the water market, and created its own water management company, Eau de Paris.
Honnêtement, quand j'ai porté la bataille de la gestion publique de l'eau à Paris, mais personne, mais quand je dis personne, personne ne pensait que j'allais réussir. Voilà. Et quand je dis personne, c'est vraiment personne. Pour avoir vu de l'intérieur, pendant près de 14 ans, le service de l'eau parisien, je suis assez formelle sur le fait que si on veut exploiter la ressource selon les intérêts du concitoyen consommateur, selon les intérêts de la ressource sur le long terme, préservation, qualité, c'est incompatible avec une logique privée. Parce que la logique du privé, c'est une logique qui sera de rentabilité de court terme. Avant, il y avait quand même au moins un peu une logique industrielle. Maintenant, il y a une logique industrielle, mais qui s'efface de plus en plus devant une logique financière, vraiment financière. Et la logique financière obéit à du court terme, voire à du très court terme. L'eau est encore du domaine, on va dire, de l'environnement. Mais on voit bien que les acteurs économiques font pression à différents niveaux, les grands acteurs privés, pour que l'eau devienne une ressource économique comme une autre. Le risque est à la fois plus grand et en même temps, il y a une mobilisation plus forte du public. Donc c'est ça qui est intéressant, c'est que je pense qu'il n'y a jamais eu autant de mobilisation autour de l'eau.
How long will the European fortress be able to withstand the financial market pressure? In 2012, a petition called Right to Water amassed nearly 2 million signatures, a first for Europe. Protesters demanded that water be given special status.
The European Citizens Initiative really changed the way we discuss about water in Europe. It helped creating a movement and a whole idea that water should be considered as a human right. Before, all the documents from the European Commission were starting to introduce market mechanisms. They were always pushing for liberalization. Now, this is not something that you can easily do. In a public way. So the official answer from the European Commission was, of course, we support the human right to water, but nothing happened. No, in real, in legislation. What is the problem to recognize the human right to water? I mean, it's a right recognized by the EU. It's something that is essential for life. The only problem is business and profit.
The Right to Water petition has so far halted the ambitions of financiers around Europe. But it remains a fragile victory.
There are two paths, and I don't know who's going to win this. It's either water is a commodity and it's going to be put on the open market for sale, or it's not. It's going to be understood to be a human right. You can't have it both ways. It's time to choose now which path.
A word on hope from each of you, please.
Well, for me, the hope is there, right?
I totally get the morality, but the world's a different place and it's changing. And it's changing fast.
Ne pas comprendre que cette matière résonne avec l'ensemble de notre culture, même de nos civilisations. se joue là un enjeu qui dépasse même public, privé. C'est l'avenir des conditions de vie pour l'ensemble des citoyens de ce monde.
Water scarcity and climate change, is it a windfall for our business? Yes, it is. Is that a bad thing? Well, I suppose time will tell.
I'd be saying don't do it. Don't take on this model. People just trying to make huge amount of money out of it. You're more or less going to have to sell your soul to get the water to be able to survive.
Today, the fate of water is still undecided. Originally, over 4 billion years ago, water arrived on this Earth from space and has since survived all manner of catastrophes. But it is now being threatened by the men who dream of turning rivers into gold. As if nature was nothing but a giant supermarket.